Good afternoon. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 4895 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on committee meeting times. Any member who would wish to speak against the motion should please press the request to speak button now, and I call on George Adam, Minister, to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 4895 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The next item of business is portfolio questions, and portfolio questions today is Rural Affairs and Islands. I would ask any member if they would wish to seek a supplementary to please press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letter R in the chat function during the relevant question. I call question number one, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it is supporting farmers to adapt to new technologies.
Minister Lorna Slater.
The Scottish Government is clear that adoption and development of technology and innovation will be a vital component toward our vision for Scottish agriculture. Central to developing solutions to the challenges facing Scottish agriculture is the Scottish Government's multi-million pound portfolio of research on the environment, natural resources and agriculture, which launched recently. In addition, measures like our Knowledge Transfer and Innovation Fund play a critical role supporting new and innovative approaches in agricultural practice. And I'm pleased to confirm that the latest batch of scheme awards will be announced shortly.
Craig Hoy.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The James Hutton Institute, along with a number of Scottish scientists and the National Farmers Union, support the UK Government's Genetic Technology Bill, which reaches its second reading next week. The legislation allows researchers and farmers to take advantage of crops which are more efficient and more climate friendly, but the SNP Green Government still insists on following outdated EU regulations which ignore this evidence and in so doing dismiss Scottish scientists who stress the benefits and safety of gene editing. So why does the Government continue to ignore Scottish scientists and farmers, and why won't the Minister commit to implementing the Genetic Technology Bill in Scotland?
Minister.
We are aware of the current debate around the new genomic techniques and how these relate to existing GM legislation. And we note in particular the ongoing consideration of this in the EU, our biggest international trading partner. The Scottish Government's policy is to stay aligned where practicable with the EU, and we are closely monitoring the EU's position on this issue. Scotland's position in response to the UKG invitation to join their Genetic Technologies Precision Breeding Bill has not changed.
And supplementary, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. George Eustace has written to the First Minister regarding the Scottish Government's position on these new technologies, and the Scottish Government is considering its position. However, does the Minister agree with me that the UK Government ought to respect the bounds of devolution and recognise that this matter and how to support Scotland's farmers is a matter for this Scottish Government?
Minister.
Absolutely. Decisions on the Scottish environment and the Scottish agriculture are matters for the Scottish Government. We want to ensure that Scotland operates at the highest environmental standards and that we protect the strengths of Scottish agriculture and food production. This ensures that Scotland is able to protect and advance the high standards we enjoyed as part of the EU, promote market access for our people and businesses, and ease the process of Scotland rejoining the EU in the future.
Question number two, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is ensuring uptake by farmers of rural payment schemes, including in relation to agroforestry.
Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon.
The Agriculture and Rural Economy Directorate and Scottish Forestry operate a number of schemes that are accessible to farmers and crofters across Scotland, and the Scottish Government communicates with potential applicants through emails, written correspondence where appropriate, as well as wider communications through social media and the press. And in addition, we offer support for potential applicants through the Scottish Government's network of local offices of the Rural Payments and Inspections Division and Scottish Forestry. We also seek partnership working through industry representative bodies such as the National Farmers Union Scotland, Scottish Crofting Federation and the Confederation of Forest Industries to ensure that farmers, crofters and forestry industry representatives are aware of and can access the opportunity to apply for public funding and support where that's appropriate.
Liam Kerr.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. It's important because Soil Association Scotland has said that farmers and crofters can play a key role in helping meet tree planting targets, and agroforestry, integrating trees with farming systems, could deliver 342,000 hectares of new woodland and trees out with woodland by 2050. So will the Scottish Government commit to making changes to the current forestry grant scheme to better meet the needs of farmers and crofters who want to plant more trees on their farms and also open up new market opportunities for timber, fruit and nuts?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises a really important point, and of course this forms part of the matters that we will of course consider when we have our consultation on the future agricultural bill too. I am in regular contact with the Soil Association. I'm aware of some of the concerns that they have. I'd also actually recently met with the Woodland Trust to hear about some of those issues that the member has raised as well. Of course, we want to make it as easy as possible for people if they're looking to integrate woodland and agroforestry in particular, because we know there are so many benefits that come with that. We want to enable people to undertake these projects where that's possible and to make that as easy as possible for people too. So I will, of course, take that into serious consideration.
And supplementary, Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. Given how effective agroforestry delivers environmental benefits without distorting the vital role of agriculture to our food and rural economies, can the Cabinet Secretary tell us when we can expect details of the new agricultural support schemes for agroforestry to actually come into effect, and which estimates the value of those schemes will be? The Soil Association estimate that delivering the support needed to meet that ambition of 342,000 hectares of new woodland by 2050 could be achieved at a cost of around £100 million.
Cabinet Secretary.
In relation to future support schemes, the member will of course be aware that we've committed to stability and simplicity until 2025. As I've already said, we'll be introducing the Agriculture Bill next year and consulting on that, where we'll be able to take all these proposals into consideration. And I would echo what you said about the importance of agroforestry and all the benefits that come with that. And as I said in my response to Liam Kerr, we want to ensure that that process is as easy as possible for people to access.
And supplementary, Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer. Scotland's ambitious woodland creation targets and the Scottish Government's commitment to enact to farming and food production mean it will likely to become necessary to identify opportunities for integrating farming with forestry. Can I therefore ask the Cabinet Secretary how many specific agroforestry applications have been issued by Scottish Forestry for on-farm tree planting?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, just last year alone, we Scottish Forestry had approved 281 woodland creation schemes, and using their management information, 206 of those were for areas that were under 50 hectares or less, so they can therefore be categorised as on-farm tree planting. But I would also want to emphasise as well that since 2015, 912 applications have been made for tree planting of 20 hectares or less by farmers and by small landholders too.
Question number 3, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in relation to its cross-government coordination on islands policies, what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with the Social Justice Secretary regarding the impact on rural and island communities of second home ownership?
Cabinet Secretary.
Scottish ministers continue to work closely to ensure an effective cross-portfolio approach, including the development of a remote rural and islands housing action plan. We recognise that concentrations of second homes can affect community sustainability. Wherever it occurs, we have taken action, and that includes the introduction of an additional dwelling supplement, a short-term licensing scheme to regulate second homes used for secondary letting, and ensured that local authorities have powers to vary council tax discount on second homes. The distinct housing needs of island communities are also reflected in Housing to 2040 and the National Islands Plan.
Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for the answer. In March, I asked the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government if she had considered a council tax surcharge on second homes. But as the Cabinet Secretary suggested, she then said that additional dwelling supplement was sufficient to tackle the issue. Can I ask if both Cabinet Secretaries have discussed that? Because in Argyll and Bute, 6% of homes are second homes, 3% in Highland and 5.7% in Western Isles, while those areas have around 50% rates of fuel poverty. And by this winter, second home owners in those areas will have shared in a £4 million windfall from the Scottish and UK Government related to council tax and energy rebates, while permanent residents in those areas
Mr Griffin,
are really
could we come to
struggling.
The question, please? Thank you.
Can the Cabinet Secretary commit to cross-government working to try and claw back that windfall and make sure that's distributed to those who need it most in permanent homes?
Cabinet Secretary.
Of course, I'm happy to commit to working across government to try and do what we can for people who live in our most remote and rural areas, as well as in our island communities, because the member does raise really important matters there. And it's one of the key issues that I hear about when I'm out and about and have visited various island communities too. But that's where I think the work that we do in the development of the Remote, Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan will be really critical to that as well, making sure that we get that engagement right. We're listening to communities, we're listening to island authorities, as well as working across government to make sure that we're putting the right solutions in place to tackle these problems.
Supplementary.
The government have pledged further action with additional powers for local authorities in their Housing 2040 plan, but there's very little detail as to exactly how this will be done. Rural communities like mine in the East Nuke of Fife are afflicted by too many second homes, depriving working people of a local home that they can afford. So when will the government set out more detail on how we control the numbers of second homes?
Cabinet Secretary.
We're going to be engaging with stakeholders on how best to support and empower local authorities to allow them to manage the issues relating to second home ownership in their areas. And that's also going to help improve community say on the way that homes are used in their areas and to make it easier for local people to stay in their area too. I would also add that to limit the number of new build homes becoming second homes, that's why we increased the land and buildings transaction tax additional dwelling supplement in January 2019 from 3% to 4% of the total purchase price for any additional home of £40,000. But that's what I would say. I'd be happy to come back to liaise with my Cabinet colleague and to come back to the member with more information as to what the timescales for that might look like.
And supplementary, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland's islands are vital contributors to our environment, society, economy, culture and heritage. Clearly, second homes have a large impact on the social and economic makeup of island communities. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what action the Scottish Government is taking in relation to the number of second homes which are used as short-term lets in rural and island areas?
Cabinet Secretary.
Action taken to regulate short-term lets with licensing schemes will be operational from the 1st of October this year. And the option for local authorities to introduce control areas to manage the numbers and locations too. I know that Highland Council have recently consulted on designating Badenoch and Strathspey as a control area. We consider that the legislation that we have is appropriate for the whole of Scotland, including island and rural communities, because it offers considerable flexibility to local authorities as to how it's implemented.
Question number four, Willie Coffey, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what engagement it had with the UK Government regarding the impact of food shortages and rising food prices in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government continues to hold numerous discussions with UK Government departments on a variety of topics relating to food resilience. And just this week, I met with the Secretary of State for Food and Rural Affairs to discuss the ongoing impacts on the food and drink sector. The UK is, of course, facing a serious cost of living crisis, and the latest figures show that inflation has reached a 40-year high at 9%. The UK Government holds many of the levers to address the ongoing pressures, but of course we will continue to use all of the powers we have available to support people in Scotland.
Willie Coffey.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? We've had stark warnings regarding food price inflation from the Chairman of Marks & Spencer, the Bank of England, and recently from the Chief Executive of the British Retail Consortium. But I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary agrees with the comments of the former Chief Exec of Sainsbury's, Justin King, who said that the current pressures started with Brexit. Well in excess of 40% of our food comes from Europe, so it started with Brexit.
Cabinet Secretary.
I would agree with that, and I think that many businesses would also agree with that comment that has been made. There are, of course, numerous challenging impacts currently facing the Scottish food and drink industry, but it is, of course, the UK Government's reckless Brexit deal that removed Scotland from the EU single market, which, of course, plays a huge part in that, as well as the significant loss that we've experienced through the loss of freedom of movement. The food and drink sector has really borne the brunt of the hard Brexit, which had been pursued by the UK Government, and particularly through the loss of freedom of movement and free trade. We did repeatedly warn the UK government that Brexit would be damaging to business as well as to trade, and we're now seeing that through decreases in our trade with the EU, as well as a huge increase in food prices in the UK.
A supplementary from Edward Mountain, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just to refer members to my register of interest. One way of preventing food shortages is empowering farmers to plan for the future, something they can't do at the moment as they wait until 2024 for the government's future policy. Failure to speed things up is not good for our farmers and food producers who've worked tirelessly, especially during the pandemic. Is the Cabinet Secretary prepared to meet as soon as possible with opposition parties to explain how this policy development is progressing and discuss whether the date for putting it into action can be brought forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
I've already outlined in previous responses today the timescales that we're looking at for introducing future legislation, as well as in relation to the consultation that will be taking place in relation to that too. But I think it's really important in terms of the process that we're following at the moment. We are, of course, discussing our future policy, and co-development is the critical part of that, where the Ariel Board is essential, because I think it is really vital that when it comes to developing our future mechanisms for support, we do that with the people that it is going to most affect. So I would say that that's what's critically important as we move through this, that we undertake and go through that co-development process when it comes to designing our future policy.
A supplementary, Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Food prices are rising, but the costs paid by farmers for feedstuff and fertiliser are also rising faster as well. What help can both our governments give to farmers to ensure food security? And will the Scottish Government now implement our human right to food to ensure that people don't go hungry?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member will no doubt be aware that obviously we have the discussions on the Good Food Nation Bill, and the final stage of that is due to happen shortly. But of course, what it does outline, that provides the legal framework. But essentially what we have been doing is we have a number of policy initiatives which are about giving, really putting in place that right and delivering on that right to food, which of course will become part of and incorporated into Scots law in future legislation too. We're committed to doing all we can to help our farmers and crofters in Scotland where it's within our power to do so. No doubt the member will also be aware of the specific issues that we've faced in the pig sector in particular, where we've again extended our hardship scheme, recognising the significant challenges that they face, and in fact all farmers face when it comes to all their input costs significantly increasing. And we continue to liaise with the UK government to see what they can do to tackle some of the bigger issues as well when that comes to fuel, energy and some of those other costs where it's not within the Scottish Government's power, unfortunately, to tackle that. What I do find, though, particularly frustrating is that we do see other initiatives taking place in other countries, other methods to help farmers put in place that, unfortunately, we don't see replicated here. But we will continue to keep that pressure up to do what we can to help Scotland's farmers and crofters.
Question number five, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it's doing to help farmers to tackle the reported increasing problem of Neospora in livestock.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government doesn't require farmers to take specific action on Neospora as it is a non-statutory disease. However, farmers do have access to subsidised surveillance via SRUC veterinary services to assist with the cost of diagnosing animal health and welfare problems.
Rona Mackay.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. I'm meeting with a local constituent this month at his farm to discuss four calves that were aborted during pregnancy due to Neospora. While dogs are a primary host for the parasite, all it can take is for one cow grazing on pastures contaminated by infected dog faeces to infect the entire herd. Can the Minister tell me what's been done to educate members of the public that when walking their dogs, they must pick up their dog mess, bag it and bin it to ensure farmers' livestock remain healthy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I know that control of this is particularly difficult because there currently aren't any drugs available to control the disease in cattle or to cure animals that may be infected with it either. However, there are certain management practices that can be applied to try and reduce the risks, and the Scottish Government has supported SRUC to make that information available to farmers as well as to vets. But enforcement is also difficult. Now, we do have the Dog Fouling Scotland Act 2003. That makes it an offence not to pick up dog faeces. But unfortunately, that doesn't apply to agricultural, including grazing land. So therefore, it is vitally important that dog owners are reminded about just how important it is to lift dog faeces. The Scottish Government has worked with the NFUS to publicise the importance of picking up after your dog on farmland as well as in urban areas, and we continue to promote that message wherever we can.
Question number 6, Audrey Nicholl. The microphone was late coming on, but please continue.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its latest assessment is of the impact of Brexit on Scotland's food and drink sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government repeatedly warned that Brexit would be damaging, and recent trade statistics only serve to underline the negative impact of our exit from the EU. In 2019, Scottish exports were growing consistently. We now know that Scotland's trade with the EU was 16% lower in 2021, with food exports to the EU down £68 million and imports plummeting down £220 million. The Scottish Government continues to use all devolved powers available to support the sector. However, more needs to be done from the UK Government now to protect our food and drink sector.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. In the last week, there has been local media coverage highlighting how North East food and drink small businesses are struggling due to Brexit, the Ukraine conflict, VAT and soaring energy costs, all issues that the Cabinet Secretary has already highlighted. Some businesses have had to make very difficult decisions, such as reducing operating hours, increasing menu prices, or even removing items entirely. Can the Minister give assurances that the Scottish Government will do everything it can to press the UK Government to do more on the issues such as VAT and energy costs, given most of these problems are as a result of the UK Government's own mess?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm happy to give the member that assurance that, of course, we will continue to do everything we possibly can as it rests within our power to try and help our food and drink sector. And, of course, we'll continue to press the UK Government because it is urgent now and more needs to be done to address these issues. And we'll continue to keep on pressing until these matters are taken seriously.
And supplementary, Finlay Carson.
We know the Scottish Government has long been opposed to the cultivation of GMO. But they clearly misunderstand there's a significant difference between genetically modification and gene editing, which the Scottish Government needs to recognise. We know that rather than decisions being science-based, this Green SNP government simply...
Mr Carson, take it we're coming to the substance of the question, which is absolutely on the bulletin. Thank you.
Yes, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government's position is simply to stay aligned with the EU, putting their constitutional obsession ahead of Scotland's food security and turning their back on world-leading crop institutions like James Hutton and Roslin Institutes. This is even after the European Commission launched a review on its own rules, concluding... Presiding Officer, I'm sorry.
I think we could all calm down and could we actually get to the question, because it is a supplementary. Thank you, Mr Carson.
Their decision is after the European Commission launched a review into its own...
Could we get to your question, please, Mr Carson? It's been quite a long supplementary. Thank you.
It's likely the EU are going to change the position on gene editing. The NFU Scotland and scientists back gene editing, so why don't you?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's a bit rich for the Tories to talk to us about not taking food security and food production seriously. Where is the task force established by the UK Government to look at food security, like the task force that we set up in Scotland to tackle the serious, the very serious and urgent issues that our food and drink sector faces, as well as our primary producers? Where is the focus on food production in terms of the English Government's future policy on agriculture? Completely absent, unlike us who have kept the focus on food production because we recognise how important our food security is in Scotland. We take these matters seriously, which is why we have undertaken the work that we have, established a task force to do everything within our power to help our producers in Scotland.
Question number 7, Mark Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in relation to the impact on the food and drink supply chain, what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the availability of allotments and community growing projects?
Minister Lorna Slater.
The Scottish Government fully supports increasing the land available for community growing, but given that this is aimed at growing food for personal consumption and not on a commercial basis, it has not been considered in relation to the food and drink supply chain. While allotments and their provision are the responsibility of local authorities, since 2012, the Scottish Government has allocated more than £1.6 million to direct support and increase the land that is available for community growing.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The Local Government Committee is currently undertaking an inquiry into this, and it's clear from some of the work we've looked at already that the local food strategies have not had the desired impact to actually empower communities to develop new allotments and community growing projects to the levels which are actually going to help meet demand. So can I ask the Minister, what steps do ministers now intend to take to help turn that around and address the blockages in the system preventing people able to grow food locally?
Minister.
Thank you very much. As the member himself will know, that we do have the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee are undertaking this inquiry, which has improved on whether the Community Empowerment Scotland Act has improved availability to allotments and whether it has reduced the barriers to accessing allotments. The committee has held the first of three evidence sessions last week and heard from a range of organisations representing allotments and food growing associations. A local food strategy consultation is underway or planned.
Supplementary, Ariane Burgess.
The Inverness-based community organisation Notnagale Limited are awaiting the outcome of their asset transfer request to convert the Scottish Government-owned Smiddy Field into a green hub with allotments, an orchard, community agriculture, space for walking and wildlife. However, the local development plan proposes a change of land use, which could allow the site to be sold for volume house building. How will the Scottish Government ensure communities are supported to develop projects which protect agricultural soil and biodiversity, like the Notnagale Green Hub?
Minister.
As noted in the question, the land is subject to an asset transfer request. It would be inappropriate to comment on the detail of any of this while the Scottish Government is still considering the request and assessing against the needs of the farm at Notnagale and the operation of the Crofting Cattle Improvement Scheme. The Scottish Government has already had discussions with the community group Notnagale Limited with regard to the asset transfer request and proposed land use change. That engagement will continue through the conclusion of the asset transfer request process.
And supplementary, Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Allotments and community growing are undoubtedly important for people to get encouraged to get engaged with the food that they eat. But does the Minister agree with me that if the Tories are really so concerned about the situations that are impacting the food and drink supply chain, that they might want to raise these concerns with their colleagues in Westminster?
Minister.
The Scottish Government takes seriously the food security of Scotland and will continue to use all devolved powers available to support the food and drink sector. It is the UK Government, however, that holds most of the levers to tackle this crisis. So we will continue to press the UK Government, urging them to do more. More needs to be done now to address these issues and to protect our food and drink sector.
And question number 8, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its priorities are for the Clyde Islands.
Cabinet Secretary.
The National Islands Plan provides a framework for action in order to meaningfully improve outcomes for Scotland's island communities. The plan sets out 13 strategic objectives which are critical to improving the quality of life for all of Scotland's island communities across all six local authority areas. Scottish ministers are committed to delivering these improved outcomes through the National Islands Plan and through other initiatives such as our programme for government commitment to support six islands on their journeys towards carbon neutrality.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Minister for that answer and I'm delighted that one of those islands is Cumbria. While Clyde Islands such as Arran and Cumbria are not far from the mainland, assistance is required to sustain the working age population. Can the Minister advise the Cabinet Secretary advise as to the Scottish Government's support for the provision of affordable housing and other ongoing efforts to attract more people of working age to live and work on Arran and Cumbria?
Cabinet Secretary.
I absolutely recognise just how critical these issues are for our island communities and we've committed to delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, of which at least 70% will be available for social rent and 10% of these will be in our remote, rural and island communities. And as well as that, we're also developing a remote, rural and islands housing action plan to really try and help attract and retain people in these communities too. However, we do know that housing isn't the only challenge and we have to work closely with regional, local and community partners to really try and address some of the wider challenges that we know our island communities face. And this year, we'll be progressing with our commitment to developing an action plan to address population decline.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on rural affairs and islands. And there'll be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change positions should they wish. Thank you.